In this video, we're going to be learning about double displacement reactions. And there's two main kinds of double displacement reactions that we're going to be looking at, and that's precipitation reactions, and I'm going to do another video for acid-base reactions. So this is one we're just going to focus on precipitation reactions. These are reactions that produce a solid or a precipitate from these. And so for double displacement reactions, how you'll identify those is you're going to start with two compound substances like NaCl and AgNO3. They're both ionic compounds with this, and you're going to make two ionic compounds as a result. So again, we're going to be predicting what the products are from these reactions, and really whether the reaction will happen or not. One of the products will be a precipitate if a reaction takes place. If there's no reaction, how we identify that is both the products will be aqueous. And so one of these four reactions that I have written here is actually going to do that, is going to have both aqueous products, so there's no reaction in that case. All right, but let's start with a real simple one here, and that's the NaCl with AgNO3. And so the steps that we want to take for this, and I wrote down some other things that you'll need as we go along here. You're going to need a list of solubility rules, which I'll talk more about here in just a second. That's how we're going to predict what our products are. This is just an abbreviated version of that. So you'll want to have that out and handy when you're practicing these. And of course, you're going to need your periodic table that has your positive and negative charges based on location in the periodic table for those. The neat thing about these is the charges don't change during the course of this kind of a reaction. So whatever charge an atom has on the reactant side, it's going to have that same charge on the product side. In fact, we'll have to do that with the silver here in just a second. All right, so let's go ahead and do this first reaction here. The way that I go about this is I'm going to bring just one of each ion over to the product side first. So I'm going to bring one sodium over, leave some space, put your plus sign for your other compound, and put the silver with that. Just one of each cation, one of each positive ion. Of course, there was only one on the reactant side, so not a big deal there, but we'll have to deal with that in some of these other ones. Then we're going to do the same thing with the anions, the chloride ion here and the nitrate ion, the NO3. And one thing I always tell my classes is that the only subscript you're automatically going to bring with it is if it's a part of a polyatomic ion, like NO3 or the 4 here in PO4 or the 4 here in SO4. That you'll come with it. Leave any other subscripts behind for those. So I got my sodium and my silver. I'm going to bring the chlorine and the nitrate over, but we're going to switch which cation they're with. So the chloride ion here is with the sodium, so on the product side, I'm going to put that chloride with the silver. The nitrate ion here on the reactant side with silver, it's going to go with the sodium on the product side. So there's my NO3 on the product side there. The next thing we need to do, and a lot of people forget to do this, especially on quizzes or exams, don't forget to do this part. You need to balance out the positive and negative charge for each product substance. We need to make sure, again, these are both ionic compounds. With any ionic compound, your positive and negative charges need to balance out. And so for the sodium, that one we can figure out from its location in the periodic table. Here it is in column 1. It's going to have a plus 1 charge for that. And the nitrate ion, you can get that from your list of polyatomic ions, which I just have a very short list of them down here, just the ones that are in this particular, these examples that I'm looking at. There's my nitrate, and it's got a negative 1 charge for that. And so if your positive and negative charges are the same, then you're done. You don't need to do anything else with that. That's the correct formula. I usually go back and erase those. I'm using a Sharpie here, so I can't erase them, but there's my positive and negative charges then. And then the Ag and the Cl. Let's start with the chloride ion, since we can actually figure out that one from its location in the periodic table. It's in the second to last column. Those all have a negative 1 charge, so we know chlorine's going to be a negative 1 for that. Silver's over here in the transition elements, and that one you can't tell based on its location in the periodic table, although you can memorize silver is always a plus 1, but you don't have to memorize it for this one here. We can actually figure out what its charge is going to be on the product side, because it's going to be the same as the charge it had on the reactant side. It was with one nitrate ion on the reactant side, which had a negative 1 charge, and so then if we kind of work our way backwards here, silver then, to balance that out, since there's only one silver, it's got to have a plus 1 charge. So if that silver's a plus 1, then so is this one over here. You only have to do that for the transition elements. Otherwise, like sodium or potassium or calcium, those you can figure out from their location in the periodic table. All right, so this turned out to be a really easy one since all the charges were positive and negative. They have plus one and negative one. They all balance out. We don't really have to do anything else as far as that's concerned. And in fact, the whole equation is balanced. I've got one sodium, one chlorine, silver, silver, and one nitrogen, three oxygens, or you could do that as one nitrate each. So that equation's already balanced. The last thing we need to do then is to figure out which of our two products is going to be soluble or aqueous and which one is going to be a solid or the precipitate from this reaction system. And so to do this, you'll have to use your solubility rules. So you want to have this handy when you're doing these kinds of problems. And so your instructor may have you memorize these. Some instructors give that to you. So it depends on who your instructor is, but you got to have that list out in handy here. So the way I've got this in every list of solubility rules can be a little bit different here. The way I've got this one set up is I've got soluble compounds up here, or ions that form soluble compounds. Again, these are going to be aqueous for us if it's soluble. And then down here are ions that form insoluble compounds. Those are going to be solids. So we'll put a little S there for those. There are some exceptions to some of these ions, though. And so that's typically how you'll see a solubility rule set up. Notice, though, there's a few of these rules that don't have any exceptions. Like sodium, potassium, and ammonium salts, they're always aqueous. There are no exceptions to that. Same thing for these ions down here. This is nitrate and chlorate and perchlorate, and this is the acetate ion there. When those negative ions are in a compound, they're always aqueous as well. So there's no exceptions for those two ions, but there are for some of these other ones. So let's see if we come across any of those for this. So let's start with sodium and nitrate. And a good rule to memorize, because it just shows up a lot of the time, is the rule for sodium and potassium. And really, it's all the alkali metals. I just put a few of them on here. And the ammonium ion, they're always aqueous. They're always soluble. So if you see sodium in a compound, it's always going to be aqueous. You don't have to worry about what the other ion is that's with it. And so we can immediately put a little AQ then behind the NaNO3 because it's going to be aqueous. We could also base this off of the nitrate ion, and it's got the same rule. Nitrates and all these other ions, they're always aqueous. They're always soluble, no exceptions there. So again, that tells us that's going to be aqueous. Then let's go with silver chloride. And this particular list, I don't have a rule for silver, but I do have a rule for the chloride ion. Here's Cl minus right here. Chloride is usually aqueous, but there are some exceptions here. So that's when we have to look at the exceptions. And if you look at the first exception there, it's when chloride is with silver. And that's exactly what we have here. And so it doesn't follow the rule. The rule is that it's usually aqueous, but if it's an exception, then that means it's going to precipitate out. So that one's going to be a solid then. So that's our precipitate. So that'll be our precipitate. That's going to form a solid. You'll actually see the solution turn cloudy, and that's what your AgCl is then, is that cloudiness that's in there. All right, let's try the next one here. This one's a little bit tougher because some of the charges are different in this case, unlike the first one where everything was a plus one and a negative one. So for this one, we've got K3PO4 and CaCl2. So again, we're going to start by bringing one of each ion over to the product side. The only subscript I'm going to bring is the 4 here that's a part of that phosphate ion. The 3 here is just telling how many potassiums I have. The 2 here is telling how many chlorines I'm going to have. I'm going to leave those behind. So I'm just going to bring one potassium over to the product side and one calcium over to the product side. One PO4, but since it's with potassium on the reactant side, I'm going to put it with the calcium on the product side there. And again, there's two chlorines here. I'm only going to bring one of those over, and that's going to go with the potassium. All right, so just figure out what your ions are and get them together. Again, we're just switching which cation those anions are with. And so the potassium with the chlorine here, we can use the periodic table for this one. Potassium's in column 1, it's going to have a plus 1 charge. Chlorine's over here in the second to last column, it's got a negative 1 charge. Same positive and negative charge, that one's done. We don't need to do anything else with that. Calcium, on the other hand, it's got a plus 2 charge. It's in here in column 2, or group 2 in the periodic table. Phosphate, on our list of polyatomic ions, I wrote that down at the bottom here, it's going to have a negative 3 charge. right? And so a negative 3 with a plus 2, that's not balanced as is. So we need more phosphates, we need more calciums, we need more of each of those. This is a great candidate for that little crisscross trick. So I'm going to cross this over. I need 3 calciums and take the 2 here. That's how many phosphates, since I have more than one polyatomic ion, I need to put it inside a parenthesis and we'll put the 2 outside of it. Otherwise, it looks like you got 42 oxygens there. All right, so we want 2 PO4 ions for that. All right, so now each of those formulas is balanced. We don't need the periodic table anymore. Now we can balance the equation for this particular system. And we could start with the potassium here. I've got 3 here and only 1 there, so I can put a 3 out in front of that. But I may need to do some other things here as well. I'm going to start with the calcium in this case. I've got 1 calcium here, and there's 3 of them over here. And so I need to put a 3 out in front of the CaCl2 to balance that part out. And now that's going to give me 6 chlorines. 3 times 2 is 6 chlorines. I've only got 1 on this side, so I need to put a 6 out in front. Can you see why I didn't want to put that 3 there? Because I was kind of looking ahead there. I figured I wouldn't need that. And so now that gives me 6 potassiums for this. I can go back over here. I've only got 3 at this point. I need to put a 2 out in front of that. That'll give me my 6 potassiums now to match up the 6 potassiums that I have there. Notice now that gives me 2 phosphorus and 8 oxygen, and that matches exactly what I have over here. 2 phosphorus and 2 times 4 is 8 oxygens there. All right, so that's balanced. There's our balanced equation. Last thing we need to do, bring in the solubility rules and go through those. And here's KCl. And again, a good rule to know off the top of your head is that potassium salts, they're always aqueous. They're always soluble. No exceptions to that. And so we can put a little AQ in there. We could also go with the chloride rule there. They're usually aqueous. And potassium, you notice, is not one of the exceptions. So it just follows the rule. It is aqueous there. And then down at the bottom of our list, we got to look at calcium versus phosphate. And down here, I've got salts of carbonate, phosphate, oxalate, chromate, and sulfide ion. They're usually solids. They're insoluble. They're going to be our precipitate. The only exceptions here are the ammonium ion and the alkali metals. That's that column 1, lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, cesium, francium. Francium doesn't do anything. And so the calcium ion there is not one of the exceptions, so that should precipitate out. That's going to be our solid then for this one. That's our precipitate. All right, and so again, that's how we use the solubility rules. All right, let's try this one. We've got sodium nitrate and potassium bromide. We'll do the same thing. Bring 1 sodium over to the product side, 1 potassium over to the product side. We're going to switch those ions. The 3 here is a part of the polyatomic ion like I have down here, so I'm going to leave that together. That's going to go with the potassium ion, the bromide ion. I'm going to switch that over. That's going to go with the sodium. And we can balance out our positive and negative charges. Here's our periodic table once again. And so what do we need? Sodium and bromide. Here's sodium in the first column, plus 1. Bromide ion in that second to last column is a negative 1, plus 1, and negative 1. That formula is already balanced. Potassium also is in column 1 here. It's a plus 1. And down here at the bottom, I had nitrate ion. That one's a negative 1. That one's all set to go as well. So that whole equation is balanced. So we got sodium with bromide, potassium with nitrate. Now we're ready. This is going fast, isn't it? We need the polyatomic ion list. And actually, we can figure everything out from this first rule here with no exceptions. All sodium salts, all potassium salts are aqueous. And that applies to both of our substances here. And so, oops, I need an AQ there because sodium bromide is aqueous. And I need an AQ there because potassium nitrate is aqueous. When both of your products are aqueous, you can just cross those off and write no reaction. If you figure that out right off the bat, then you're ahead of the game there. But sometimes you got to figure out what ions you're putting together before you can make that decision. So if both your reactants are aqueous and both of your products are aqueous, usually that's going to be a no reaction then for that. All right, let's try this last one. We've got barium ion with nitrate and sodium ion with sulfate. Again, we want to bring just 1 of each of those, so we're going to leave behind some of these subscripts. The only subscripts we're going to bring are those that are a part of the polyatomic ion, like the 3 in nitrate or the 4 in sulfate ion. So we'll bring over one barium, leave some space there, and one sodium. Yes, there was two here, but I'm only going to bring one of those over for that. And then the NO3, we're going to leave behind the subscript 2. The NO3 is going to go with the sodium, so we'll put NO3 there. And the SO4 that was with the sodium, that's what we're going to put with the barium ion there. Right. Now we need to balance out those positive and negative charges. So back to the periodic table. Again, you got to have all this stuff handy when you're doing these things. And so for barium with sulfate, barium's in the second column here, way down near the bottom. And that's a +2 charge. So I got a +2 there for barium. Sulfate ion, I wrote out down at the bottom here, it's a -2. So -2 there. I've got the same positive and negative charge there. I don't need to do anything. Don't crisscross that because you've already got the same positive and negative charge. It's already in its simplest form, so that one's done. Sodium with nitrate, again, sodium. You start memorizing these after a while just kind of by default, not on purpose. But sodium's a +1, and nitrate ion here is a -1 charge. So same positive and negative charge there. That one's all set as well. Now we can balance the equation. I have one barium. I have two NO3 groups here, but only one NO3 group on the product side, so I need a 2 out in front of that. And then I've got two sodiums there. Hey, look, putting the 2 in front balances out the sodium, so we don't need to do anything else there. And I've got one sulfur and 4 more oxygens, one sulfur and 4 more oxygens there. That's balanced then just by putting that 2 out in front. All right, so the equation's balanced. Last thing we need to do, bring back the solubility rules. Can you figure out which one of these is already going to be aqueous? There's our sodium salt again. So if you see sodium in a compound, you can pretty much automatically write that AQ in there. That lets you focus in on the other substance there, the BaSO4. And so let's find sulfate ion. Here's sulfate ion. Sulfate, it's under our usually aqueous substances here, soluble, aqueous, same thing there. But there are some exceptions, and that second exception in barium ion with sulfate ion should be a precipitate then. It does not follow the rule for sulfates. So barium ion with sulfate, that's going to be your precipitate. All right. So again, it doesn't, it's not always the first or the second in there. Again, hopefully you see that from this. That's how you complete double displacement reactions.